Hi, everybody, and welcome to TensorFlow Meets. It's my great honor today to be chatting with Megan Kacholia, engineering director, right, on TensorFlow. So can you tell us a little bit more about what it is that you do?
Sure. So I'm an engineering director on the TensorFlow team. I've been with the team for a little over 2.5 years now. I've gotten to participate in all of the dev summits, which has been really exciting.
Nice.
Just to get to come, be part of the keynote, be part of the event. In terms of what I actually do, so I'm one of the leads for the TensorFlow team, just help with obviously the team itself, make sure we're going in the right direction, and make sure that we're doing the right things by our community.
So one of the things that you spoke about that I saw that a lot of people are excited about, and I know I'm personally excited about, is just really how we're doubling down on making it very developer friendly in
Yes.
TensorFlow. So how did that come about, and can you tell us a bit more about it?
Obviously, we've taken a lot of feedback from the community just to see like what are the pain points, what works well, what doesn't. I think that's a big part of it. And just in general, TensorFlow has been around. Like I said, we just had our third birthday in November, right? So things change, right? The industry is really moving quickly. Machine learning is advancing in lots of different places than we might have anticipated when TensorFlow was first developed. So we need to make sure that we're making it very, very easy for folks to just come in and get started and be able to take advantage of all of the cool things happening in the machine learning space.
Right.
So I think really think it comes from kind of both of those angles, just how things have moved so fast and just the feedback we've gotten from the community as we've had TensorFlow out there for a few years.
Yeah, I mean, I've been working on it for about a year and a half, and I came in with a developer background. And when I started trying to kick the tires on TensorFlow, there were some things where it was like, it just wasn't quite intuitive to me, but a lot of that has been changing, right? And the stuff like Keras and other things and the eager execution by default that you've been adding, just hopefully will make it a lot easier for other developers.
That's correct. We want to make sure, obviously, that the flexibility and the power of TensorFlow is there. But also make sure it's approachable and easy for people to just come in and be like, it's fine, start here on this surface. And if you need to dive down to this part and really get into the guts of it, you can, it's fantastic. But you don't have to if you don't need to.
Right, and all of this doesn't come at the cost of performance, right? Because you had that great slide with performance. And can you tell us a little bit about the performance improvements that you've been seeing with TensorFlow?
Yeah, so a lot of those improvements as well, we're looking at just kind of the core TensorFlow, right? Kind of if you think of like the heart of it. And that's where the majority of the improvements come, meaning that those improvements will be applicable whether we're talking about TensorFlow 2.0, whether we're talking about using Keras or something else. It's that big meaty part kind of under the hood. And a lot of it comes from just better making use of the different types of hardware, making sure that we're using the different types of accelerators appropriately, understanding the limitations and restrictions for things like mobile, right? We talked about a lot of improvements for performance on TF Lite as well. And again, some of it is just understanding what do the workloads really look like, what does it look like on some of these different devices and edge TPUs and things that we're trying TensorFlow out more with now. And then kind of always going back and closing the loop and being like, okay, this is how we can make it better, and this is how we can make sure that the users get that performance by default and don't have to necessarily know what magic had to happen under the covers for it to happen. They should just get it.
Right. Now, you've mentioned like on mobile with TensorFlow Lite, and we lovingly call it TF Lite. And one of the things that I do get a lot of questions about is that there's all of these different almost parts of the family of TensorFlow. And can you give us a quick summary of like the different runtimes that are available for developers, like between TensorFlow Lite and what others are there?
So there's TensorFlow Lite. There's more higher level types of things that we talked about with TensorFlow Extended. So that's not necessarily a different runtime, but it's more kind of just how do you put things together end to end, especially if you're looking more towards like a production environment. We talked a bit about JavaScript as well. So TensorFlow.js. And I think that one, it's a language type thing, right? Because you want to make sure that the JavaScript community, it's such a large community that they have access to machine learning as well. But there's also just the whole in-browser experience that it plugs in well with because of Node.js. So I think a lot of it depends on what kind of applications people are interested in and kind of where they're coming at machine learning from. There's so many different ways of applying machine learning, whether you're thinking of it from like, oh, you know, I work in a large company, so I need it for these enterprise use cases, or oh, I'm just an app developer, I'm trying things out myself, right? Or I'm someone who's really familiar with this language, I'm really familiar with JavaScript, so that means I can use that as kind of my entryway to start doing other things in machine learning. So I think some of it depends on where you're at, where you're coming from, and then we try and make sure we have the right way for you to to get into the machine learning community.
The JavaScript stuff is amazing in the fact that you can actually train models in the browser.
Yes.
You know, when I first heard about that, I was like, nah, come on, really? But you actually can do that.
Yes, so, it's really cool.
And as you mentioned then with Node, you're not just limited to in the browser, you can run it on backend servers and that kind of stuff. And one of my personal favorites actually is with things like Cloud Functions or Cloud Functions for Firebase, because they run Node.js.
Yep.
You can actually start putting models in there. Now, TensorFlow 2 is currently an alpha release, right? Now, lots of people are asking, what comes next? When are we going to see a release candidate or something like that?
Yeah, so like we talked about at the Dev Summit, we're going to have our release candidate kind of coming up sometime in Q2. We want to make sure that we're giving ourselves enough time to make sure we have good performance, make sure we have the right fit, finish, and polish for everything. Mm-hmm. But there is, like you said, an alpha available. We want feedback from the community. We want to understand what are people enjoying, what's working well, what are they concerned about. And you can also follow along on GitHub and kind of see like what features are coming out, what status are things at. That way the community knows what's going on, and we can make sure that we're engaged appropriately to be building the right things as we finalize and finish up with the 2.0 release.
Sounds perfect. Thank you. So people can stay tuned to GitHub and keep track of everything that's going on.
Yep,
so.
That's correct.
Okay, so thank you so much, Megan, and thanks everybody for watching this episode of TensorFlow Meets. If you've got any questions for me or any questions for Megan, just please leave them in the comments below and check out the GitHub page for TensorFlow if you want to learn more about the TensorFlow 2.0 release. Thank you so much.